Welcome, Trojans, to What Matters to Me and Why. Happens every month. A chance for all of us in our Trojan family community to get to know, in a personal way, our professors, our administrators, staff people here at USC, and find out what's behind the person who's giving those lectures in the classroom. Find out the life story behind the people who make this place hum and tick. So today we're really excited to have our head of the philosophy department here at USC. I went over to Mud Hall and went into his office. And have you ever been to his office in Mud Hall? Go there and you'll feel wiser just going in the door. It's got, you know, old paintings and wonderful old books and bookshelves. That's worth a trip just in itself. A couple things just to share by way of announcements. This series happens every month, first Wednesday of the month here at Ground Zero. And sorry we can't give you free chocolate milkshakes, but, you know, afterwards you can order those. A couple of events going on here very shortly for the Office of Religious Life, which hosts this series. One is we're having a prayer vigil next Monday night at the Caruso Catholic Center at 7 p.m., praying for peace and harmony in these interesting times, praying before the election for unity and supporting each other and respectful dialogue. So that'll be happening 7 p.m. at the Catholic Center. Also this Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, there's a sacred thread, sacred space conference going on to which all of you are invited. And you can talk to myself or Sherry. Sherry, where are you? In the back. Sherry will help you orient to that. And it's really going to be a fascinating series of lectures and events about the role of fabric and veils and vestments in spiritual, in the traditions of different religions in their temple worship. It's really going to be interesting. So if you want to learn more about that, talk to us. Without further ado, I would like to introduce one of Scott's students, Nikhil Goyal, who will introduce our speaker. Thank you, Nikhil.
Hi, I'm Nikhil Goyal. I'm an undergraduate philosophy student here at USC. I was one of Professor Soames' students last semester, and I'm here to introduce him on a bit of more personal level. He was my professor last semester in an analytic philosophy course, and I knew it was going to be a very special course from the beginning because he invited me, along with the only two other students enrolled in the course, to meet in his office in Mud Hall, which is just as gorgeous as previous speaker mentioned. And I also knew that he was a very special professor in the sense that he was very intense. He wasn't afraid to stare you in the eye if he thought that you weren't grasping a concept or he didn't quite understand what you said. But he also held himself to high standards. I don't think I've ever received such detailed handouts fleshing out everything that we were going to talk about from any professor. By the end of the semester, my entire room was overflowing with papers from Professor Soames. Beyond that, his spirit of generosity was evident beyond offering his office as a space for us to meet. He would always make time to meet with students and provide copious comments on any work submitted to him. And he is just a genuinely great conversationalist. And I really enjoyed my time in his course. One of the stories he told us was about his time before USC as a young faculty member at Yale. When he departed, one of his colleagues said that he was sorry to see Professor Soames go because Professor Soames was one of the few on the faculty who was willing to admit when he was wrong. And all of my interactions with Professor Soames and my time in the class cohered with that account of Professor Soames, and I'm very excited to hear what he has to say, and I'm sure that you'll all find it very edifying. Thank you.
for coming. I didn't know quite what to expect. I've only been in this Ground Zero coffee house once, and that was to hear a student band, which was really pretty good. I hope that I'm up to that level of performance, but I'm not sure that I will be. I'm planning to speak for about 20 to 25 minutes, after which I hope we'll be able to have some discussion. Now, in order to keep my length at that amount, it's going to be a bit dense. There's going to be quite a lot of content in what I hope will be a minimum of words. So those of you who are eating lunch, be warned. All right. When I began thinking about trying to answer the question, what do I care about, I realized that the answer had to come from the most intense concerns grounded in my daily life now and for decades. These concerns are, and have been, the people on whom and the things on which I have spent nearly all of my life's energy. At the center is my family, my wife Martha, my sons Greg and Brian, and the family I grew up in. Martha and I have been together for 15 years and married for 12. It was meeting her that drew down the curtain on what was a dark decade of my life following the deaths of my parents. I can say that I wouldn't be here today without her. My sons, Greg and Brian, have always meant the world to me. Unfortunately, they too lived through their own difficult years, but they righted themselves and they're thriving today. I would say that they're my proudest achievements, except for the fact that they're not my achievements. The credit is really theirs. Now, my life has also been enriched by my childhood friends, school friends, former teachers and students, colleagues, past and present, and recent friends, like Frank Price, who is here today. Some of my friends and loved ones are dead, and some are distant, but I carry them with me. In addition to particular people, the deepest concerns in my life include institutions and historical traditions. The most important to me are the discipline of philosophy, its modern and ancestral home, the university, the great tradition of Western civilization, and the leading edge of that civilization, the United States of America. I will say a word about each. The first sentence of Aristotle's Metaphysics is, "All men by nature desire to know." What we most desire to know are not particular truths of sense perception, but general truths that explain what we perceive in terms transcending our perception. Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle realized that this knowledge requires precise concepts, concepts like number, element, point, line, shape, circle, sphere, circumference, area, dimension, space, volume, matter, density, body, velocity, motion, direction, proportion, cause, change, permanence, quantity, and quality. All of these concepts deployed in accordance with strict rules of logic. That was the force motivating Socrates' relentless quest for definition. The project of securing precisely defined concepts and using them to discover the knowledge that all men by nature desire is what mattered to Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. In addition to knowledge of the physical world, they realized that we also seek knowledge of ourselves, our essential human nature, the good lives we aspire to live, and the good societies to which we hope to contribute. Because of this, they made it a founding principle of Western philosophy that knowledge of these normative matters can be as objective as non-normative knowledge, and so requires precise concept of goodness, happiness, virtue, and justice applied with the same rigor as scientific and mathematical concepts. It is to them, I believe, more than any others, that we owe these world-transforming ideas. These were the ideas that made Plato's Academy the first European university, integrating philosophy, mathematics, logic, and natural science. The rediscovery of these ideas in the late Middle Ages and early Renaissance initiated the process of reconciling faith and reason and fostered the turn toward empirical observation exemplified by the 13th century monk Roger Bacon. In the early modern era, philosophy, physics, and mathematics were revolutionized by the likes of Kepler, Galileo, Descartes, Boyle, Newton, and Leibniz, each of whom was part philosopher, part scientist, and part mathematician. It was also then that Locke developed his theory of natural rights and limited government. Hume followed, giving us a non-egoistic theory of human nature capable of supporting morality, as well as a social philosophy rejecting rationalistic schemes of social organization and championing naturally arising institutions. All of this set the stage for The Wealth of Nations, written by the holder of the chair in moral philosophy at Glasgow University, Adam Smith. Together, Locke, Hume, and Smith made a case for free men and free markets that helped spark the greatest advance in human well-being that the world had ever seen. Closer to our own time, the German philosopher and mathematician Gottlob Frege invented modern symbolic logic and contributed with Bertrand Russell to providing the set theoretic foundations of mathematics. Gödel, Tarski, Church, and Turing followed, developing the mathematical theory of computation that led to the digital age. In the first half of the 20th century, philosophers made seminal contributions to Bayesian theories of rational decision that were later used by Nobel Prize-winning political economists to develop theories of utility-maximizing behavior in political and economic settings. In the second half of the 20th century, philosophers of language and logic developed the foundations for the scientific study of meaning in natural language, while other philosophers helped psychology move beyond Freud and Skinner. The work continues today. This is the discipline I hope to advance through my research and also through our efforts at USC to build, if I may say so, a modern Platonic academy that connects philosophy to all areas of intellectual inquiry. Now, I realize that this vision is too grand for me to completely fulfill. So I aim merely to advance it which is a level of aspiration that works for me. The goal is clear enough to be visualized. It's limited enough to make my progress apparent. It's definite enough to allow me to plan future steps, and it's ambitious enough to ensure that I won't be left without a guiding star. It also connects me with others, current and former students, colleagues around the world, plus new people I meet when lecturing in China, Peru, Costa Rica, Russia, Europe, and elsewhere, sometimes generating new joint projects. This brings me to the modern university, about which I care deeply. Despite its many achievements and its illustrious history, I believe it faces serious problems today. Here in the United States, it's become too expensive, too dependent on an intrusive government, and too sharply divided between the natural sciences and the rest. Some parts of it are, I think, insufficiently demanding intellectually, as well as being too ideological. As a result, a chasm has opened between the university and the public, which is coming to see it more as a gatekeeper for a credentialed, ideologically homogeneous elite than as an institution that rewards talent, industry, and intellectual integrity. To bridge this chasm, we need to renew our commitment to free inquiry, to the goal of helping students become disciplined, independent, and well-informed thinkers, and to the production of new knowledge across the disciplines, whether or not that knowledge confirms present preconceptions. Now, professors today typically think of their research as their most important product. And perhaps it is. But if generating new knowledge is our most important goal, we should do everything we can to share it with our students. In my courses, I try to help students understand past philosophical perspectives and use them as a basis for devising better ones that advance the subject. My aim is to help them acquire the skills and the knowledge that they need while inspiring in them a commitment to search for the truth, no matter where it may lead, while respecting others' attempts to do the same. It's not really an easy lesson. The challenges facing Western civilization in general, and the United States in particular, are those of the university writ large. I think that too many members of the cognitive elite emerging from the university, from which our leaders are mostly drawn, are ignorant and contemptuous of the giants on whose shoulders they often stand, and of the burdens borne by ordinary men and women in building our civilization. Representative democracy, limited government, universal suffrage, the rule of law, free markets, economic opportunity, free speech, and free thought are, I think, threatened. These problems are more than political. They spring from who we are. So who are we? Well, who am I? I'm not a citizen of the world, nor would I be, even if I thought that all cultures and forms of government were equal, which I don't. I believe in American exceptionalism. We were the first self-governing nation. Our audacious experiment has been admired and emulated for more than two centuries. Beyond that, I am, of course, an American myself. These are my people, this is my place. Its history is my history, and its challenges are my challenges. I care about other places and other people, and I try to help when I can. But my home is my first concern. Now, not surprisingly, I think philosophy has something to say about this. According to David Hume, reason selects the means to our ends, but our ends come from what we most need and desire. Although we are virtuous as well as self-interested, the interaction between the two is complex. Were the virtues not distinct from self-interest, they wouldn't be virtues. Were they not intertwined with self-interest, we wouldn't acquire them. Because cooperation promotes survival, we've been bred by natural selection to be social animals. It's not just that we need what others can provide and so are impelled by self-interest to cooperate with them. We are also disposed to form powerful cognitive and emotional attachments to them. Parents are innately disposed to nurture and love their babies. Children naturally bond with parents while emulating those with whom they are intimate. In our early years, we form reciprocal bonds of affection and trust in which our well-being and self-conception is intertwined with others. Entering into games and collective activities, we learn the rudiments of fairness, which involves adhering to common rules and earning rewards proportional to the value of our efforts. This fusion of natural sentiment with rationality, I believe, gives birth to morality. Sentiment infuses our participation in group activities with those we like and admire, and who we hope will like and admire us. Our interaction with them is frequently guided by impersonal rules that apply to anyone who occupies a given role. Because these rules define the terms of our participation in mutually beneficial effort, it is in our interest to obey them. But they are more than prudential rules of thumb. Because the parties involved are often comrades bound by ties of affection and social affiliation, rule violations carry psychic risks beyond the loss of purely self-interested benefits secured by participation. Violations of rules governing interaction with our socially affiliated fellows are affronts to them, to our friendship with them, to our image in their eyes, and to the people we ourselves want to be. With this, instrumentally useful rules, obeyed to secure the benefits of group action, become principles to be honored, even when no one is looking. This, I believe, is how sentiment, social affiliation, and recognition of mutual interests generate the binding commitments and principles of morality. Now, I find this picture inspiring, but I also see its limits. Our psychobiologically based morality develops out of attachments and sympathies growing out of our early childhood experiences with parents, siblings, relatives, close friends, and companions. They are the ones with whom our interests and identities are intertwined, the ones to whom we are instinctively connected, and the ones to whom we are, in the first instance, morally obligated. As we grow older, the circle expands, but the difference between the moral significance of those close to us and those further away, in my opinion, remains. Our duties to those who are near and dear are different from and more urgent than our duties to others. Modern economic and technological circumstances have expanded the circle of those to whom we feel bound by reciprocal commitments. But it doesn't erase our differences. Attempts to enlarge the circle must be taken with care. The cry, liberty, equality, and fraternity, led first to the guillotine and then to Napoleon. more recent variations have led to the gulag, to starvation, to mass murder, and poverty, wherever totalist ideologies have been backed by state power. I don't think this is an accident. It's the recurring result of pursuing the utopian dream of replacing our innate but limited moral sense with a one-size-fits-all prescription for humanity as a whole. The inevitable product of this utopian dream, which reassures its proponents of their own enlightened nobility, is nothing short of hatred of those who resist the dream. And also of contempt for those in whose name they erect undemocratic and ultimately repressive means of social control. No, I'm not a citizen of the world, but I am someone who is deeply embedded in it with concerns far beyond myself. If I weren't, I couldn't face the loss of those I love, or of my own inevitable decline and death. There was a time when death loomed very large to me. In 1987, I rushed across the continent to spend a 3-week-long goodbye with my dying mother. When the end came, I wasn't able to make peace with it. When, in 1990, I lost my father in the same way, the world went dark. Fortunately, that's behind me now. Thanks to Martha, Greg, Brian, my close friends, students, and colleagues. Thanks to my work in philosophy. Thanks to USC for letting me try to build something great here. I'm blessed in a way I never imagined. As I've gotten older, my horizons have expanded rather than narrowed. I've learned to care more deeply about people and things that will outlast me. And as a result, I've become happier and less dismayed over my own inevitable demise. Nor am I dismayed over what I believe will come in the far distant future. The extinction of human life and the obliteration of any consciousness that we were ever here. Not a happy thought, especially for one like me who lacks any religious conviction. If, unlike me, you find an answer in religion, then more power to you. The religious impulse must, I think, always be respected. But for me, the answer is different. And perhaps deceptively simple. Time isn't the measure of value. The fact that something isn't eternal doesn't mean that it isn't important. And like Forrest Gump, that's all I have to say about that. Now, is there a time for discussion? I don't know how it works here. No? There's a place with a microphone.
Yeah, so I guess people should just raise their hands and.
And you'll go over to them with the microphone. Why don't you start, Nikki?
No. I haven't formulated a question yet, but.
Does this work? Yes. Okay, so if you, obviously you believe that philosophy is like the mothership of where we are today, correct? How we became divided?
I am writing a book called The World Philosophy Made. So perhaps the answer to that is yes.
Yes. Okay, me too. So then I also believe that philosophy is what will ultimately lead to the right answers to the questions of how we got here and how we can make it better. You agree as well?
If they're going to be answers, they're going to come from us.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
First of all, I much appreciated your remarks, and especially the point at which you made. You talked about the sort of the circles of care or the circles of loyalty, and as somebody who works very hard to build community among young people. A lot of times I have people say to me that they're concerned about tribalism. And if I understood you correctly, you're sort of saying like tribalism is a real thing and it's not necessarily a bad thing.
It's an inevitable part of our human nature. It's something that doesn't have to be limited to a small tribe, but we start out, our values are formed in very intimate situations and we naturally develop, I think, a set of emotional and moral concerns to the people who are nearest and dearest. It is a fundamental challenge to the human race to gradually expand that kind of circle, and we are gradually expanding that kind of circle, but it must be done appreciating who we are, what our limitations are, and how attempts to force things prematurely too far can lead to terrible disasters.
And this is my question for you, is that when it comes to tribalism, if I understand evolutionary history at all, we've sort of survived as human beings by, on the one hand, cooperating, but on the other hand, competing.
Yeah.
Like there's both these things going on. And the tribalism sort of is a part of the cooperation point, but tribes are over and against each other.
They certainly have been for a very long period of time.
So here's my question is, do you think there's any kind of philosophical or, in your case, personal experience where you would say that there's such a thing as a tribe that can be defined that's not us against them or us over them, but rather us for them, where the us still is defined?
Of course there is.
But there's connection, and I'm just wondering where you would find that.
Of course there is. I mean, I think you find it, you know, all sorts of places in history. Go back to the early history of the United States. Go back to just before the Civil War. What communities did people like Robert E. Lee feel they belonged to? Robert E. Lee was a great general in the American Army. And he was the one that the North wanted to lead them. And he was not a slaveholder. But his loyalty was to his state, the state of Virginia. And that led him to make that decision. Now, what would happen today? Our loyalties are not that localized, not as localized as they once were. The country as a whole, the country in Western Europe, the country in our southern border, they expand over time. And it's not an accident that they expand over time because of commerce, of technology, of communication, of travel. This has the effect of, does it erase the difference between the nearest and those further away? No. But it lessens it and it takes that, it can take that sharp competitive edge off. And that's a process that I think we should be hopeful of. and we should try to advance. But we should do so in a step-by-step way and not risk the disasters that have occurred in some societies.
Hi, thank you for being here. My question is, in light of what you're saying about American exceptionalism and the U.S. as leader of the Western world, how would you approach issues such as mass incarceration, extremely high cost of healthcare, probably the highest cost of education here, in light of the fact that all of these industries are moving toward being more government-led? So in a country where I'd probably say we probably have the most private institutions for education, where we're shifting towards a government-led healthcare plan and prisons that are led by the government, how would you approach that with your thoughts on limited government? Or at least what I saw as your
I think the steps that have been taken recently in these areas have not been well thought out and have led to very serious problems that are going to require quite significant modifications. And I do not think that they will be as uniformly led by the government as many people might suppose. I think it will be a combination of public and private. Now, I'll say something, because you mentioned education too. One of the great things about this country is we have so many private universities and colleges that can have their own vision and pursue what they take to be the most important things in life. Not many countries in the world have this. We do. I want to see that preserved and strengthened, and I fear something which I find insidious, and that is, it's not an accident that schools like USC and Princeton and Yale and Stanford and all of that have been raising their tuition at basically double the rate of inflation for decades. And they're able to do this in substantial part because the government has taken over many of the institutions for financing higher education, and they're pouring more and more money into student loans. And when this happens, there is a danger. This is bad for students. I mean, it's not making college any more affordable for you, because the tuition increase, what they're doing is they're increasing my salary. That's basically what they're doing. And they're increasing the salary of the administrators, and they're hiring a great many more administrators to interact with the government, which is paying a larger and larger amount of bills. And we have something called the accreditation process now, in which a federal entity comes out to USC, to Harvard, to Stanford, to George Mason University, and they ask us to do certain things. Is there a real danger that USC and Harvard and these other universities shouldn't be accredited for offering the degrees that they offer? No. This is a means, this is the camel's nose under the tent, in which these universities are gradually being brought to heel and learning where their bread is buttered. And for those of us who are permanently at the university, does it really hurt us? No, our salaries keep going up, that's good. But it's not good for the society. It's not good for the relationship between the university and government. And it's not good for you, the students. I think,
I'm not a social theorist. I don't know how to devise institutions nor programs that will address this. But I do think we need the right, forgive me, philosophical perspective. We want to keep the freedom, the independence that the private universities have been so important in upholding in our history until now. And I don't want to see further encroachment. I think it's very worrisome, and I think it's almost invisible to people, but it's happening.
You were talking about the growing divide between the natural sciences and philosophy.
Yeah.
And many natural scientists, I know, tend to be fairly derisive about philosophy. Why do you think that is, and what do you think can be done to fix that?
I'm sorry, I missed. What was it that you didn't think? Maybe I missed it.
Many scientists tend to be fairly derisive of philosophy for whatever reason. And my question is, why do you think that is the case, and what do you think can be done to fix it?
Many scientists have this attitude towards philosophy. Well, I think it's a two-way street. I think we in philosophy haven't, in every case, trained ourselves up to the level at which we need to be trained up to deal with physics and mathematics. But in the leaders in these fields today, in philosophy of mathematics and philosophy of physics, are interacting with the physicists and the mathematicians. And I think the more that we do this, the more that the physicists will begin to see. Look, what's going on when you produce a physical theory? One of the things you want to do is whatever your theoretical mechanism is, you want to make sure you get some pretty good predictions out of it. But another thing you want to do is say, what is it really telling us about the universe? And that's a question that contemporary philosophers of physics have things to say about. And I think one thing I'd like to do at USC, and you know, we've hired somebody who I think will help us do it, is to start a progressive master's degree in philosophy and physics. And the chair of the physics department and I have been planning this, and you know, I think it will happen. We've just made an initiative. We've initiated Antonio Damasio of neuroscience into our department. I'm having discussions with one of his students about trying to do something jointly in his education between neuroscience and philosophy. I think this is a tremendous opportunity for both sides. And I just think that we need to take advantage of it. And as I say, part of the problem is philosophy needs to take this broader perspective that I've tried to fill out and to apply it to the present day. And I think if we take the initiative, we will find people in physics, we'll find people in mathematics, we'll find people in neuroscience that want to interact with us, and we'll start developing ways to do that. That's what philosophy departments should be. They should be platonic academies today. And I think if we can start that here, people will be copying us. And in 10 or 20 years, that question won't be so obvious.
I'm afraid we only have time for one more question. Sorry.
First of all, thank you again for your remarks. my question deals with the idea of the university as gatekeeper. First of all, when has it not been?
When
the university as an institution actually been inclusive?
I would say probably not in the second half of the 19th century. In the United States, probably not in the first half of the 20th century, where most of the leaders in private and public life were not always coming from leading university. I would say if you go back, take just in the political realm, if you go back to 1980, I know that was before most of your time, but there was this guy who went to a fifth-rate school called Eureka College in Illinois, and he had the audacity to run for president, and you know what? They all thought this was ridiculous. The guy is not qualified. I was at Yale at the time, an assistant professor. And I was at the master of Trumbull College's house. And there was a dinner party for recent graduates, people who had gone to school and then went out to Washington, D.C. to work and came back. And there was a primary coming up. And everybody was talking, and my wife and I were sitting there rather quietly because we had a different point of view. And everybody was asking each other, who are you going to vote? And everybody was, well, it's got to go for Kennedy. Oh, you can't go for Kennedy. No, you got to do Carter. Carter's got to be the one. And finally, people realized we hadn't said anything. And so they said, who are you going to vote for? I said, well, I'm going to vote for Reagan. And the room erupted. How is this possible? This is supposed to be a smart guy here. He's at Yale College. The master is having him for dinner. How is that possible? They said, well, have you ever heard him speak? And I said, yeah, you know, I find him a pretty good speaker. And he said, well, yeah, so simplistic. He's not very smart. I said, you know what? I don't think he's smart enough to be a professor at Yale. But I think he's plenty smart enough to be the president of the United States. And somebody, some kid, you know, kid, just got graduated a year ago, was sitting by my wife, and he said, God, don't you realize those guys are only for the rich? Of course, that guy was probably rich from saying that, but my wife said, do you know how much my husband makes? And the kid said, no. And she said, well, he makes $15,000. And the kid shut up, because he was already making. I don't think it's inevitable that there be a kind of finishing school for the elite and that those people must be the ones to run society. I have more respect for the common, ordinary people I grew up with. So that's just me.
Thanks very much for a wonderful talk.
What is it?